Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Gloria Jean Sweetlove. I am chair of the NAACP Committee on Membership and Units, and I am allowed to be president of the Tennessee State Conference, NAACP, and members of the National Board of Directors from Brownsville, Tennessee. It is my privilege to serve as chair of the NAACP Thalheimer Awards Committee, which precedes this dinner. Now, let us welcome the Reverend Dr. Dante Quick, senior pastor of the First Baptist Church of Lincoln Gardens, Somerset, New Jersey, who will give us the invocation.
Good evening. You are blessed in the regard that the person standing between you and eating has the last name Quick. It is my privilege and honor to stand and represent the more than 6,000 members of the First Baptist Church of Lincoln Gardens, where DeForest Sorries is our pastor emeritus. As we come to this evening, I come representing Gladys Bueller Hawkins, my grandmother, who cleaned the White House and emptied its trash cans for more than 20 years to send me to Morehouse College. I represent her and all the possibilities that the NAACP has created for its future. Let us gather in prayer as we proceed to eat. God of our weary ears, God of our silent tears, the God who has seen us through Nixon and Reagan and Trump, the God who found her foundation on the shores of Africa, the God who traveled across bloody seas and brought us through Haiti and the Carolinas, the God who marched us through Selma and kept us safe on buses in Anniston, the God who reminds us to shake off our bourgeois wrappings and seek the lost, fight for the oppressed, the God who has led us to Atlantic City. May that God, called by many names, some will call that God Allah, others seek that God through Jesus. But whatever we call, we thank you, Lord, that you have given us something to eat tonight when so many within a one block area will be hungry. Thank you, Lord, that you have given us something to drink tonight when Flint, Michigan still has no clean water. Thank you, God, for men and women who answer your call and rise to fight so that your melanin people will have a voice in a world committed to our silence. Now allow what happens to here to be used for your glory, that the voiceless will find a voice. Allow what happens here to empower us to leave this place and fight the good fight. Allow us to leave here in the humility of our ancestors and the royalty of the saints. In your name we pray, amen. Thank you very much.
Hey. Here to sing the national anthem and the NAACP hymn, Lift Every Voice and Sing, NAACP Image Award and Grammy nominee, Michael Kilgore.
Oh, say Can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling seas. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day begun, let us march on till victory is won.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give another round of applause to Michael Kilgore. Since 2013, Congresswoman Joyce Beattie has proudly represented Ohio's 3rd Congressional District. In its 117th Congress, Beattie served as chair of the Congressional Black Caucus. Congressman Beattie is a vocal leader and advocate for the issues impacting Black Americans, including voting rights reform, police brutality, financial inequality, diversity and inclusion, health care access, and gun violence prevention. In July of 2021, she was arrested while protesting for voting rights in the U.S. Senate. That same year, She was pepper sprayed in Columbus, Ohio, while protesting the murder of George Floyd. As chairman of the Congressional Black Caucus, Congresswoman Beatty has been instrumental in the crafting and passage of key bills and executive orders. In 2021, she was credited with uniting Democratic Congress members in support of the $1 trillion bipartisan infrastructure plan, which will rebuild America's roads, bridges, and rails, expand access to clean drinking water, ensure every American has access to high-speed internet, tackle the climate crisis, advance environmental justice, and invest in communities that have too often been left behind. That same year, she helped achieve a decades-long goal of enshrining Juneteenth as a federal holiday when President Biden signed the Juneteenth National Independence Day Act. She also serves as a key advisor to President Biden as he drafted his 2022 executive order addressing police brutality. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me and welcoming Congressman Joyce Beatty to the stage.
Thank you. Good evening. It is indeed an honor to join you tonight in NAACP. Thank you. And thank you to our colleague, our friend, and our partner, President and CEO Derek Johnson. I am the ninth Black woman to serve as chair of the powerful, oldest caucus in the Congress, the Congressional Black Caucus. We have a 50-year history of representing 80 million Americans and 18 million Black Americans, fighting for justice in civil rights, women's rights, criminal justice rights, reparations, and yes, voting rights. Tonight we say thank you, NAACP, for honoring one of our own. Thank you for your rich history. But tonight, our leader, our majority whip, the most powerful Black man in the United States of America, will stand and receive the Spingarn Medal of Honor. We say to you, Jim Clyburn, thank you, thank you, thank you. But I am not here alone. It gives me great pleasure to be with members of the Congressional Black Caucus, but NAACP family and friends, they are not just members of the Congressional Black Caucus. They are bad brothers and sisters who rule in America. But most importantly tonight, they are life members of the NAACP, every one of them. And let me start, because we are also joined with the chair of the DNC, our leader, Jamie Harrison, who hails from South Carolina, life member of the NAACP. And now, for my colleagues, I could not be more honored than to stand with them as we deliver a justice, Ketanji Brown Jackson, deliver on voting rights, John R. Lewis, deliver on policing, the George Floyd Justice in Policing. Join me as I ask Congressman Stanford Bishop, Georgia, to please rise. Congressman Bobby Scott, Virginia, to please rise. Congresswoman Sheila Jackson Lee, Texas, please rise. Congressman Emmanuel Cleaver, Missouri, please rise. Congresswoman Frederica Wilson, Florida, please rise. Congressman Stephen Horsford, Nevada, please rise. Congressman Troy Carter, Louisiana, please rise. These are the members of Congress who stand with me and represent the Congressional Black Caucus, 58 members strong. Mr. Jim Clyburn, we love you, we salute you, and we honor you. Thank you, my members. And just in case you didn't know, I am Congresswoman Joyce Beatty, Chair, Life Member, the great state of Ohio, and I approve this message. God bless you.
Thank you, Congressman Beatty, and thanks so much to members of the Congressional Black Caucus for being here. And we can't tell you how much we thank our award winner for being here. At this time, we'd like to acknowledge the Thalheimer Award winners who represent NAACP branches and state conferences, which have excelled in various programs and activities, contributing to the ongoing effectiveness and success of the NAACP, both in their communities and on a national level. Will the Thalheimer Award winners please stand? We congratulate these units and state conferences for their significant achievements and their role in providing much needed support for our campaigns for equal opportunity and full citizenship rights for all. Thalheimer winners, we thank you. You may be seated.
Please welcome NAACP board member, Dr. Hazel N. Dukes.
Keeping with our constitution of this great association, 113 years old, we had an election for a member to the board of directors by you, the delegates. We had a runoff election according to our constitution and bylaws. I'm pleased to say the winner of this election is Alice Huffman, from Saturday, Mississippi.
Now, to introduce our sponsor, Solois Steel, member NAACP Foundation Board of Trustees. Moved around in a state of alert. There's nothing new or sharp about the cutting edge. If they build a wall, let's jump the fence, I'm over this. Cold stairs can never put the fear in me. What we built here is...
Good evening, everyone. I am feeling blessed to be with you tonight. We are fortunate the NAACP has friends in the corporate community who are sponsoring our Spingarn dinner this evening. We wish to reiterate our appreciation for their generosity as we look forward to continuing our mutual cooperative relationships. We are delighted to express our gratitude for the support of Shannon A. Brown, Senior Vice President and Chief Diversity Officer, FedEx Express, Memphis, Tennessee, and Nicole Thomas, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Advisor, FedEx Logistics, Memphis, Tennessee. We would also like to thank longtime Spingarn sponsors, JP Morgan Chase and UPS. So many partners are dedicated to our work at the NAACP. We are so thankful for those who help us make your convention experience memorable. Join me in expressing a hearty thanks to our silver sponsors, Ford Motor Company, JP Morgan Chase, and Wells Fargo. Our bronze sponsors, Airbnb, AT&T, Bank of America, Culinary Institute of America, and UPS. Our partners, the Coca-Cola Company, Google, Honda, McDonald's, Prudential, State Farm, and Walmart. Our supporters, AtlantiCare, Bristol-Myers Squibb, Caesars Entertainment, ESRI, FedEx, GEICO, Lyft, Marriott, MGM Resorts, Nissan, Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, Sodexo, Southern Company, Toyota, and Verizon. Our friends, AT&T, AFT, Compassion and Choices, Hershey, Reach Beyond Solutions, and SAG-AFTRA. Your continuing support makes this possible. We extend our sincere gratitude.
Hello, I'm Shannon Brown, Senior Vice President of Eastern Division, U.S. Operations, and Chief Diversity Officer at FedEx Express. Nearly 50 years ago, FedEx invented an industry, and today we connect 99% of the world's GDP. Each day, we handle more than 15 million shipments using 697 aircraft and 210,000 vehicles. From COVID-19 vaccines to baby formulas, FedEx is on the front lines helping to deliver positive outcomes for our communities. The team that energizes this high-impact world of FedEx is 600,000 strong. Our people represent different races, cultures, religions, lifestyle, and ideas. Together, we have made FedEx one of the world's most admired companies and best companies for diversity. As FedEx celebrates 5 decades of service and innovations, we are proud of the long-standing relationship we built with the NAACP. And we are maintaining this legacy by embracing diversity, equity, and inclusion in our workplaces and communities every day. Our commitment is evident in our hiring, training, and promotion practices, in our community outreach and charitable contributions, and in the amount of business we do with minority-led firms. In addition to the NAACP, our community's investment includes the National Civil Rights Museum, the National Urban League, the National CARES Mentoring Movement, Black Enterprise, the National Black MBA Association, the Thurgood Marshall College Fund, and our support for historically Black colleges and universities. One of our success stories is the work we're doing with the Mississippi Valley State University. FedEx has placed a business operation right on campus. That means our students are able to go to classes, then go to work for FedEx without leaving the campus. They get paid, they get benefits, and they are learning about global trade, and they are being groomed for success. This is one of the many examples of how FedEx is investing time, talent, and resources in diverse communities. Tonight, FedEx joins the NAACP in recognizing an HBCU trailblazer whose devotion to civil and human rights has earned him the 2022 Spingarn Award. Congressman James Clyburn, we congratulate you and extend thanks to the NAACP for continuing on the path of freedom, justice, and equality for all.
Please welcome Jamel Hester, Chief of Staff to the President of the North America Operating Unit of the Coca-Cola Company.
Good evening. I say good evening. All right. Well, this has been an amazing convention. And if you were here this morning, you probably felt the electric feeling that we did. Just so amazed at what these filmmakers created today. The Coca-Cola Company is proud to be a partner of the NAACP, specifically to sponsor the cinematic film competition. They really blew us away under the leadership of my good friend Logan here. Did a phenomenal job, and I would just tell you, I had a different task until this morning. So some of you all were here, some of you were not. But I would tell you, it was power, was it not?
Absolutely.
My job, that's right, my job tonight initially was to announce the winners. We were gonna text and vote on the best film that we all were experienced this morning. However, you all spoke very loudly. And for those who don't know, I would just say we'll have to help you get caught up. But on behalf of the Coca-Cola Company in partnership with NCAA, all of the filmmakers that submitted films into this competition will go to the NAACP Image Awards next year through our sponsorship, through our partnership, and with partnership with the NAACP. So let's give all of the filmmakers a round of applause. Please stand where you are. Thank you, Chairman Russell, Vice Chairman Boykin Towns, and President Johnson. I can't see you, but thank you so much for your partnership. We appreciate you so much. And before I step away and we turn it over to let you see this content, I want you to share a little bit more about what you have done to lead these fine young women and men.
Oh, wow. Good evening. I wasn't prepared to speak, so I'm be brief, brother, be brief with y'all. These filmmakers came out and from different parts of the country and participated in a 5-day intensive short film competition. I'm proud of them. They created some really amazing films. If you haven't seen them, go to the NAACP.org and check them out. We have a little short video we want to show you a little behind the scenes of the process.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Welcome to the 2022 NAACP Cinematic Shorts Competition. Excited to have you. The theme of the NAACP's convention this year is This is Power. So we're going to be developing some documentary short films around the subject of power and what power means in the Black community.
I called on my dear friend, writer, producer, actress, Susan Kelechi Watson, to come share some wisdom with the filmmakers.
Social justice is really a great theme to try to create around because it is really about your passion for that cause.
This year, it feels like the ultimate honor to be able to come in here and create and collaborate with some of the top filmmakers in my generation and have the support of the NAACP.
I'm really excited to see who's going to be in attendance because we have some really powerful questions that we're going to be answering to really hone in on how we can continue to build power within the Black community.
And I just love the fact that the NAACP has created this platform for Black filmmakers, and I feel like we're going to create some beautiful stories, and I'm excited to be a part of this competition.
So every year for this competition, we tackle issues around social justice and how that affects Black people in America and globally in the diaspora. So I'm really looking forward to these filmmakers creating and crafting compelling stories. Now, it's time to get to work.
The best sort of surprise in all of this is being able to connect with other creatives. Like, I was so amazed when Susan popped in and Michelle Hare from Coca-Cola came by. I was able to talk with her not only about what I'm doing here, but like a larger vision and my larger passions. And I'm really glad that the NAACP thought that far in advance to have a wide array of people represented to support us. It's been really amazing.
Huey Newton once said, and I'm paraphrasing, that The revolution is for the young. The revolution is in the hands of the young. And to some extent, through this work with the filmmakers, we're able to get their take on what revolution means to them.
Please enjoy your meals. Dinner is now served.
Yo, everybody, come get your bounce on. Get your bounce on. Get your bounce on. Don't be cute with it. You gotta get, come on. Fifth ward. Fourth ward. Come on. Sing it.
Brighter, 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 br
wait. Think I wanna hear some horns.
You know, people have no idea what you went through to get to where you are. So many times it seemed like it was over. But God, Isaac Carey, tell them about it.
Every time I think that I'm all by myself. Yeah. I just look up in the sky. And that's where I find my help.
Somebody needs to hear this right here.
You might think that you've got it all worked out.
Yep.
And you think that everything's okay. Yeah. There ain't nothing that you've done to deserve His mercy and His grace.
He gives us what we don't deserve. That's why we say it's amazing.
You were about to lose everything.
Yep. I know I'm not the only one who's been there.
When the doctor said any day.
Yep. He made the doctor.
And the devil tried to test your faith.
He thought he really had you this time.
Why you should still be alive.
Let me think about it.
Yeah.
I don't have not one, Ozzy.
That accident did you pass last night was meant to take your life.
If you be honest, if God hadn't covered you,
it would have been you in the grave.
Yep.
Could have been you with the pain.
Right.
When the judge said 20 to life, should have been calling your name, but God. Ooh, there ain't nothing that you've done to deserve His mercy and His grace.
Can I get a witness on that?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Isaac.
Woo. You were about to lose everything.
Then you went back and they couldn't find nothing.
And the devil tried to test your faith.
If you're grateful for a but God in your life,
yeah.
Just say,
nobody.
Talk to him. I
just know that there ain't no situation that you come out of on your own. Right in the middle of the last storm in your life. You might have thought you were by yourself, but He was right there by your side. You were about to lose everything.
In the hospital with your baby.
When the doctor said any day.
He stepped in. Survivor listening, who's ever been counted out and even canceled out, and your situation may have looked impossible, And now people are looking for an explanation on how in the world you made it through what you went through. I don't want you to let everybody in all your business, but I just want you to look at them and give them the short version of your testimony. And just tell them, you know what? It was nobody. Yep.
Set me free. How you made a way out of the way. Turn my darkness into day. You fill my joy in the time of sorrow. Hope for my tomorrow. Peace in the time of storm. Strength when I'm weak in war. I can never repay you for what you've done for me. How you lose myself to then set me free. How you made a way out of the way. Turn my darkness into day. You fill my joy. Of sorrow, hope for my tomorrow, peace in the time of storm, strength when I'm weak in war. I can never repay you for what you've done for me. I lose myself to then you set me free. Hold me away out of the way, turn my darkness into.
good morning or evening, friends. Here's your friendly announcer. I have serious news to pass on to everybody. What I'm about to say could mean the world disasters, could change your joy and laughter to tears and pain. What I want the world to know is love.
Has gone too far. You think we've gotten too radical with our message? Well, I got news for you. You ain't heard nothing yet. And if you don't know, now you know. Glory, glory! Woo! You better put them hands together and act like you know up in here. Cheap Pete!
Lately, I've been going through something that's really got me down.
Put your hands together.
church up in here. Come on, chat.
You have to help me find out what happened to my husband.
Seeking answers is never a straight line.
Oh my God.
Police are closing the case.
His widow deserves answers.
You saw the same thing I did. You still want to face it.
Michael. Gonna do the podcast, force the police to look deeper into the case. I won't only find out what you want me to know.
Air it all.
This season, we will present the information ignored by the media and the police.
We know what our friends want us to know about their marriages.
It's Micah lying to me.
I'm worried about Bobby. Her marriage. She's coming loose at the seams.
Do you trust her?
If you don't work with Poppy, she'll work against you.
She lies. Tried to gaslight me.
How does that make you feel?
Like burning it down. You thought that you could control me.
I don't know what you're talking about.
You have to be honest with me. Why did you even want me involved with this case? My name is Poppy Parnell, and I will not give up until I have the truth.
I know your secrets. I know your lies.
All my people say,
stop.
All my folks say,
stop.
My cousins say,
stop.
My auntie say,
stop.
It ain't over. It ain't over.
Shout out to my cousin Nick, to my auntie Nick, A1 Swift Nick, Chris and Alicia Nick, all the homies Nick, all the believers Nick, John P. Key Nick, Hezekiah Nick.
Lord have mercy.
lives. Y'all feel that? Can't nobody do you like Jesus.
Can't nobody
do me like Jesus.
Do me like you, Lord.
When I found myself standing all alone, see the ones I trusted, they didn't love me, no. 'Cause when I looked around, my family and friends were gone.
Can't nobody
do it like you, Lord.
Stays the same, everything changes every time I call his name.
Mama told me where my help comes from, yeah, and when things get rough, I know just where to go. There's a peace, y'all, that I just can't explain. Hey, for those who don't know, it ain't nothing but the Holy Ghost.
Can't nobody
do me like you, Lord.
Can't nobody.
Everything changed when I called your name. I've searched the world to find someone who could fulfill all my hopes and my dreams. What I found out is that no one could love me, Lord, the way that you love me.
Can't nobody
hold me in the midnight hour like you, Jesus.
We all have open cup.
Now, coming to the stage, Elaine R. Jones. Now, coming to the stage, former president and director counsel, NAACP Legal Defense Fund, Elaine R. Jones.
The lights are bright. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. At this time, we are continuing our program. I am Elaine R. Jones, chair of the 2022 Spingarn Awards Committee. Thank you. I am honored that our chair and vice chair and NAACP leadership have given me this extraordinary privilege. Now, as this, the 113th convention of the NAACP draws to a close, we can each, or we should each, return to our communities with a renewed sense of commitment. We've got work to do. And the knowledge that this has been an extraordinary week. We have been energized by presentations from dynamic leadership, and we have heard from experts and national political leaders who have shared their plans, their goals, and expectations for the balance of the year and the future. Now it's time to get to work. Relationships have been renewed. We have glad-handed and hugged one another, bumped and done all of the things we do to greet and see one another. We have exchanged ideas, and hopefully we have learned much that we will put to good use in our communities across the nation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we have a special someone in our audience tonight. We have a lot of special someones, but we have this special someone in our audience tonight who has asked for no recognition, but who deserves our gratitude and our thanks for his extraordinary accomplishments. Now, it's not who you think I'm going to say, but tonight, we have among us our 106, our last year's 2021 Spingarn recipient, who we need to take the time to honor because COVID protocols prevented our doing it the way the NAACP likes to do it. So, our special person tonight is Dr. Cato T. Lawrenson, MD, PhD, our 106 NAA Spingarn medalist. Dr. Lawrenson, let there be no mistake, is a star. And the association last year, as every year, selected carefully. And we selected well. Now, Dr. Lawrenson, as we take the time to say a word about him now, has been and is a pioneer in the fields of engineering, science, and medicine. We, the NAACP, recognize his seminal and singular accomplishments in tissue regeneration, biomaterial science, nanotechnology, and regenerative engineering, a field that he founded. His exceptional career has made him a leader among peers, the few that he has. He is almost peerless. Now, combined disciplines, engineering, physician, and scientist. His breakthrough achievements have resulted in transformative advancements in improving human life. His fundamental contributions to material science and engineering include introducing nanotechnology into the biomaterials field for regeneration. Ladies and gentlemen, we of the NAACP do ourselves a disservice if we do not enthusiastically and robustly celebrate this scientific genius in our midst. Dr. Cato T. Lawrence, please stand. Number 106 last year. Thank you so much, Dr. Lawrence, for giving so much of yourself to us. You have asked for nothing and have given all, and we thank you from the bottom of our hearts. Don't leave here without seeing him tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I welcome to the podium NAACP President and CEO Derek Johnson, who will bring greetings.
Good evening. You know, every year we convene at this convention, this is the 113th convening of the NAACP. And for me, there are only two important functions. One is our legislative day, where our members across the country establish the policy and priorities and directions of the organization, because we are truly a small D democracy. But secondly, when we come for the closeout banquet and celebrate Black excellence. And tonight is unlike any other night and special to me. But I received a call earlier from a good friend of mine, Cedric Richmond. And Cedric said, hey man, it's really important that you share with the audience that I couldn't be there, and Secretary Fudge couldn't be there, and Congressman Thompson couldn't be there. I said, Cedric, I'm not gonna do that. Because Secretary Fudge came to us on Monday and she lit the stage up with her conversation. And Chairman Thompson has been leading the January 6th hearings like it's been masterful the way he has navigated those hearings. So Cedric, you don't have an excuse. You're just hanging out in New Orleans or something. So for Secretary Fudge and Congressman Thompson, you know, Whip Clyburn, they apologize they can't be here with you tonight. Cedric don't have an excuse, so I'm not gonna give an excuse for him. I want to thank all of you who have joined us this evening, members of Congress who came in and they were able to suspend votes. And Congressman Thompson have to say, there's no substitute for being in power. And because in the House, the Speaker recognized the significance of this moment, they completed their votes at 3 o'clock so members can come here and be with us as we celebrate the honoring of the Spingarn Award on Whip Clyburn. So I want you to enjoy that steak, if your steak tastes as good as mine. If it don't, I'm sorry. I want you to enjoy the camaraderie of those around your table. But more importantly, I want you to take in this moment. Because for 113 years, we have celebrated Black excellence, and tonight will be no difference. Peace and power.
At this time, I ask Ms. Brianna Reeves, youth member, NAACP Board of Directors, Culpeper, Virginia homegirl, to come forward and pay tribute to the living Spingarn medalist.
Good evening, everyone. I said, good evening, everyone. Are we doing okay? Okay, are we doing okay? Can y'all talk back to me a little bit? All right. So on this occasion, as we gather to celebrate the awarding of the 107th Spingarn Medal, it is fitting that we acknowledge those living medalists who also share this singular honor. They are members of a superb group of individuals who have achieved excellence in their chosen fields and have also served concurrently as catalysts for the improvement of society, most particularly for the cause of civil rights. These distinguished Americans of African descent have not only helped fashion our history, but are an integral part of the present and are reaching emphatically into the future. The most recent winners are the 104th medalist Patrick H. Gaspard, the 105th medalist Misty Copeland of 2020, and the 106th medalist Dr. Cato T. Lawrenson of 2021. Thank you.
Here to share the purpose of the Spingarn Medal, Chairman of the NAACP National Board of Directors, Leon W. Russell.
You've been so good to us. You brought us from a mighty long way. That's why we love you. Come on.
Fired up. Fired up. Good evening. My purpose this evening is to explain the purpose of the Spingarn Medal. Now, it's obviously in the Spingarn Medal book, but it's important that we emphasize to you that the medal has a twofold purpose. First, to call attention of the American people to the existence of distinguished merit and achievement among Americans of African descent. And secondly, to serve as a reward for such achievement and as a stimulus to the ambition of colored youth. Now, that language was created in 1914 by the late J.E. Spingarn, who was then chairman of the board of directors of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. Spingarn gave annually until his death in 1939 a gold medal to be awarded for the highest or noblest achievement by a living American Negro during the preceding year or years. He established a fund in perpetuity for the purpose of annually presenting this medal. We are following the highest tradition established by J.E. Spingarn so long ago. This 107th medal, in my opinion, is one of the most important, along with Dr. Lorenzen's, that we have ever given. I just want to say to all of you that our 107th award winner has a birthday tomorrow. And so all of you should remember that as we proceed through this program. Thank you.
Now that I got your attention. Yeah. Hey. How you doing? How you doing?
This program is now wholly dedicated to honoring our 107th Spingarn Award recipient, our 2022 recipient. However, it is not my place to speak of him tonight, but this chairman is bursting with pride at just the thought of this honoree. Hold on to your seats, for we are about to experience overwhelming appreciation and enormous gratitude. I am now pleased to welcome Vice Chair of the NAACP National Board of Directors, Karen Boykins-Towns, to introduce our presenter for the evening.
We the best music.
We the best music.
I worked my whole life for this one.
Good evening. Another one. Congressman James Clyburn has asked his dear friend Brenda Murphy to present our 107th NAACP Spingarn Medal. Ms. Murphy, the first, I repeat, the first female elected to the post of president of the NAACP South Carolina State Conference. Yes, yes. She is an advocate for justice and equality for all people with a passion to serve others. A recipient of many, many honors, Ms. Murphy was recognized as an outstanding nurse during her tenure at the South Carolina Department of Mental Health. A charter member of the Delta Eta chapter of Chi Eta Phi Nursing Society, she was recognized as one of the 2021-50 most influential persons in Columbia, South Carolina, as published in the January 2022 issue of Business Monthly Columbia. Please join me in welcoming President Brenda Murphy.
You know I love music. And every time I hear something hot, it makes me want to move. It makes me want to have fun. But it's something about this joint right here. This joint right here, it makes me want to...
Good evening. I would like to acknowledge Chairman Leon Russell, Vice Chairman Karen Boykin-Towns, President and CEO Derek Johnson, other members of the National Board of Directors, and members of this great association, and special guests that are here tonight. I am Brenda Murphy, as you've heard, the president of the South Carolina State Conference, NAACP. I have the honor and privilege of introducing to you the 107th recipient of the Spingarn Award. It is with great pleasure to present to you someone whose sphere of influence and impact includes politics, education, and social justice. The 2020 election left little doubt of how influential this recipient's influence was throughout not only South Carolina, but throughout the United States and the world. And that is an honor is well deserved. It is well deserved. I'm going to be honest with you. I left my paper in my hotel room, so I'm trying some new technology tonight. I'm using my telephone, so bear with me. Please bear with me. Our recipient of the award is a native of Sumter, South Carolina, and he defied all stereotypes types throughout his life and has made destroying broadly held myths about black people his highest priority. The NAACP has been a part of the Congressman's life from a young age. He was elected president of the Sumter Youth Council before his 13th birthday and was elected the first African American, as we all know, congressman from South Carolina, the state of South Carolina, in nearly a century. He was raised by nurturing parents who ensured an environment that taught him to be responsible and to gave him the tools and the information that he needed in order to be a successful black man. His father was an advocate as a minister, always advocating for justice, and his mother also was a businesswoman who was a beautician, someone that we ladies respect. Congressman Clyburn graduated from Mathers Academy in Camden, South Carolina, and matriculated to South Carolina State College, which is now a university. He continued with that same sense of thirst for justice, and he became, well, not only became, because he still is, he became a risk taker, getting into good trouble. He helped to organize many civil rights marches and demonstrations as a student leader of the South Carolina State College. He became an organizer in the Student Nonviolence Coordinating Committee. He met Emily, his wife, in jail following a student demonstration in Orangeburg, South Carolina. He organized sit-ins at the South Carolina State House as well. And he does not lead himself to classification or categorization. He has been in public service in one capacity or another throughout his life, being a longtime congressman from one of America's most impoverished districts. He has formed his career out of being a change agent, carrying the torch, justice for all. Being able to stay focused, fighting forward for justice for all people. His leadership role in the United States House of Representatives include, but is not limited to, House Majority Whip and Chairman of the Select Subcommittee on the Coronavirus Crisis, which continues, as we know, to pay its to move things forward as a founder of multiple initiatives, including the House Rural Broadband Task Force, which was badly needed in South Carolina, especially in our rural areas. And not only South Carolina is he concerned about, he's concerned about the nation. So not just South Carolina, but the nation as a whole. Each of us has the responsibility to make the world a better place for those who will follow. Congressman Clyburn ran 3 times for the elective office, and he didn't get up. This just demonstrates his fortitude, his tenacity to achieve that potential position that where he would be able to impact on the life of his people. This, there's an old spiritual title, Let the Work I've Done Speak for Me. Congressman Clyburn is a true personification of this, as he has enacted multiple legislative into law and has made a difference to those in his community and other communities. The first bill he co-sponsored after being sworn into Congress was to raise the minimum wage, and I'm certain all of you remember that. Okay. Congressman Clyburn, he was one of our only two freshmen of the 103rd Congress to have a bill become law as a national leader. He has championed rural and economic development, and many of his initiatives have become law. His 10, 20, 30 federal funding formula was introduced in four sections of the American Recovery Reinvestment Act. Congressman Clyburn is a passionate supporter of historic preservation and restoration programs. His efforts have restored scores of historic buildings and sites on the campuses of historically black colleges and universities. His legislation created the South Carolina National Heritage Corridor and the Gullah Geechee Cultural Heritage Corridor, elevated the Congaree National Monument to a national park, established the Reconstruction Era National Monument in South Carolina Lowcountry, and addressed the history of discrimination against black farmers with the codification of black farmers' settlement. Congressman Clyburn has led an extraordinary life. In his memoir titled Blessed Experience, Clyburn tells his own inspirational words how an African-American boy from the Jim Crow era South was able to beat the odds to achieve great success and become, as Barack Obama describes him, one of a handful of people who, when they speak, the entire Congress listens. It captures his more than four decades in public service and the barriers he has broken as the most significant African-American member of Congress. Congressman Clyburn has many memberships and affiliations. He is a life member of the NAACP and has received numerous awards, including over 30 honorary degrees from universities and colleges. He serves on the board of directors for Allen University in Columbia, South Carolina. He is a proud member of Omega Psi Phi and a fraternal member of multiple Masonic organizations. Yeah. Forgive me, this phone is giving me, it's challenging me up here, but I'm gonna make it through this. Okay.
If there is any consensus on Capitol Hill, it's that House Majority Whip James Clyburn pleads to win. From broadband in rural areas to community health care centers, from enhanced background checks to the Historic Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act. For James Clyburn, legislation that helps the average American is what winning is all about. It wasn't power that James Clyburn was after when he won the congressional seat for South Carolina's 6th District in 1991. His goal was, and has always been, to make life better for the constituents that he serves. Although Clyburn studied history at South Carolina State University, growing up in the Jim Crow South gave him all the lessons he needed to understand about the imbalance of power in the United States. But his parents taught him the power of faith and industry. As a young college student, he was arrested countless times while protesting for civil rights in the 1960s. It was then that he realized the power of the people. Through John Lewis, Bill Clinton, and yes, Joe Biden, it was the power of friendship. Through his love of golf, he learned the power of building bridges. And through his beloved wife, Emily, he appreciated the power of love. As he rose to become the highest-ranking African-American in Congress, James Clyburn understood that power was to be used judiciously. A self-professed liberal, he pushes for restructuring healthcare, education, and the judicial system.
We don't need to make this country great again. This country is great.
That's right.
Our challenge is making the greatness of this country accessible and affordable for all.
Quoting Tocqueville, Clyburn says that our nation's greatness is in its ability to repair our faults. Yet the student of history warns us that we are again facing the fierce urgency of now. Progress, transformation, repairs, and reforms are in jeopardy, and voting rights are rapidly eroding. So, in 2020, James Enos Clyburn summoned all the powers he'd cultivated over the years.
I want the public to know that I'm voting for Joe Biden. South Carolina should be voting for Joe Biden.
This endorsement single-handedly revived Joe Biden's presidential bid and paved the way to the White House. In return, James Clyburn's ascension as kingmaker was cemented. And like the great leaders before him, he fights for equity, justice, and democracy for all.
Okay, I'm going to say this. I was told to have this prepared speech, but I'm like this. I generally speak best when I say to you what I want to say naturally. So what I'm going to say at this point is that, and I think it's very important, I need to recognize his family because Congressman Clyburn lived in our state of South Carolina, in Columbia, South Carolina. I had the opportunity to work with his wife, who I love dearly, who is now deceased, but we worked together at the VA Medical Center in Columbia, South Carolina, until she retired. I also want to recognize his daughter that's here. He has three daughters. One is with us, Mignon. Would you please stand? Thank you. Thank you. Congressman Clyburn is very special to us because of the work that he's done, and we want to salute him. We salute him for all of his contributions and his advocacy work throughout the many years, as starting not only as a congressman, but as he worked in South Carolina for the human rights of individuals. I will leave you with this. We, not only South Carolina, appreciate and salute him, but also the State Conference of Tennessee, the State Conference of Florida, and I'm certain many of you salute him and appreciate his work as well. So without further ado, I introduce to some and present to others, Congressman James E. Clyburn.
Thank you. Thank you very, very much. I want to begin by thanking my president, President Murphy, for such a kind presentation here today. And I also want to acknowledge Mary Robinson, to somewhere out there, thank her for her friendship over the years. I want to thank the chairman of the board, Leon Russell, President and CEO, Derek Johnson, and I understand there may be about 50 NAACP members from South Carolina, the various branches over the state. Please stand. I thank you as well. Thank you so much. Thank you. You just met my daughter, Mignon. My brother John is here. John, I grew up with two brothers, one of whom is here with me tonight. But I got a couple of cousins over there. William Clyburn and Cheryl Crawford from Boston, Massachusetts. Sarah, thank you so much. Now, those of you from Massachusetts, Cheryl may not have told you that she was a Clyburn before she was a Crawford, but I want to thank her for her friendship as well. Now, many of you will be pleased to hear this. We came in from Washington, as many of you know, accompanied by several of my colleagues in the Congress. In order to get here, we had to pitch in together and charter a plane. And we got to get back tonight. And there's a certain slot that we have to get into Washington on, or we won't be able to get in, which gives me about 10 minutes. And that's all I'm going to take. When I was growing up in Sumter, my mother, the beautician, had a rule that every day after school, I had to stop in the beauty shop to let her know how things had gone for the day. On one of those days, I stopped in, and there was a lady there who had grown up with my mother over in the cotton fields of Lee County. Mom's was their favorite beautician, and they would drive 25 miles from Bishopville over to Sumter to get their hair done. On this particular day, when I walked in, the lady looked at me and said, "My, my, how much you have grown since I last saw you." And then she asked a question that was asked by so many in those days. "What it is that you want to be when you grow up?" I started telling her about my dreams and aspirations. I wanted to finish high school, go off to college, and I wanted to get involved in politics and government. She looked at me and very sternly said, "Now, young man, don't you ever let anybody else hear you say that again." Now, that lady was not throwing cold water on my dreams. She just felt that a little black boy in Sumter, South Carolina, with those kinds of dreams and aspirations, would be better off keeping them to himself. But that night, Mom's closed the beauty shop, came back into the house, and called me to the kitchen table. And she said, "James, don't you let what that lady said to you today deter you from your dreams. Don't you listen to her. You stay in school. You play by the rules. Stay out of trouble. You are going to be able to fulfill your dreams and aspirations." And because of the NAACP and the many people that joined with them, starting out with the case in Sumter against the Sumter branch, Shep Nash against the NAACP, my mother went out to raise money to defend the branch. And Matthew Perry came to Sumter to defend the NAACP. And my mother closed the beauty shop that day and told me to get in the car. She wanted to take me down to the courthouse. She wanted me to see what I could be when I grew up. I have never forgotten that. I saw Matthew Perry defend the NAACP. People from all over Sumter came to the courthouse to watch that black lawyer make mincemeat out of all of those in the courtroom. I have never forgotten that. And when I got elected to Congress, the very first bill I introduced was to name the new courthouse that was going to be built in Columbia, the Matthew J. Perry United States Courthouse, and it is there today. As a monument to the NAACP and what it has meant. Now, today, there's still work to be done. I remember studying at South Carolina State a man named Alexis de Tocqueville. De Tocqueville once wrote that America is not great because it is more enlightened than any other nation, but rather because she has always been able to repair her faults. There are a lot of faults still need to be repaired. And we in the NAACP, we in the Congress must do everything that we can to make sure that we repair those faults. We all have roles to play. Only 435 people can serve in the House of Representatives. Only 100 can serve in the Senate. That is the limit to how many can serve in the Congress. We have a job to do, and we must do it well. You in the NAACP have got a job to do, and we must help you do your jobs well. If you do your jobs and we do our job, we will be able to fight off everything that's being contemplated and being attempted today. If it's happened before, it can happen again. When Reconstruction came to a close, Jim Crow came into being, we did not give up. We kept fighting. We fought through cases like Cruchot, cases like Plessy versus Ferguson, and we finally got Brown v. Board of Education because we did not give up. And we are not going to give up now. We do not care what is done by those who are trying to keep us from achieving what this country has for each and every one of us. Our parents made big sacrifices for us. We must make big sacrifices for our children and for our grandchildren. We must not let anybody, any organization, no matter what position they hold, keep us from passing on to our children a country a little bit better than that which was passed on to us. So I want to thank you tonight for recognizing me in this way. Thank my family, my staff, my friends, my neighbors. I just hope that after this birthday tomorrow, which is going to be my 82nd, I just hope that I live long enough, that I serve well enough to prove myself worthy of this great honor. Thank you, and Godspeed.
Will the Spingarn Committee please join Congressman Clyburn on the stage?
We've been scorned. We've been two eyes to make a pair. Brother, we can't quit until we get our share. Tired of beating our head against the wall and working with someone else. Say it loud. Say it loud. Say it loud.
Keep it, keep on. Never say die. Keep on.
Will the family of Congressman Clyburn please come to the stage?
Talk about it. If I make a move, What about the love coming with me? What about the neighbors coming with me? What about the sea that's coming with me? The people that you came with coming with me? What about the love coming with me? What about the neighbors coming with me? What about the sea coming with me? People that you came with, you're coming with me.
Now, to offer the benediction, Reverend Dante, Reverend Dr. Dante Quick.
Fearing me, there's a movement we've been grooving on. You can move or stay your ass asleep. Let's just not talk about it.
Good evening. As we prepare to leave this place, let us prepare to leave in prayer. The hermeneutical foundation for our closing prayer comes from the writer of the book of Genesis. In the fourth chapter of Genesis, God asks, "What have you done? The blood of your brother is crying out from the ground." As we leave this place, the blood of Jalen Walker is crying out from the ground. The blood of Breonna Taylor is crying out from the ground. The blood of students in Texas is crying out from the ground. The blood of seniors in Buffalo are crying out from the ground. Let us not leave satisfied, but let us leave responding to the blood of our brothers and sisters crying out from the ground. Let us leave resolved that God is charging us, that we respond in the grandeur of the NAACP. Let us pray. God, we thank you that you have brought us this week to scheme and plot to respond to the blood that is crawling out from the ground. The blood that is called from the founding of our nation. The blood of lynching trees. The blood of grandmothers and grandfathers. The blood of Ghanaians and Nigerians stolen from their continent. And that blood cries out today from Texas to New York to Baltimore. Here we are, Lord. Send us, resolved, committed, that we are your freedom fighters. Now we stand on the shoulders of Du Bois, on the shoulders of Sojourner, on the shoulders of unnamed men and women who responded to the blood crying out from the ground. Here we are, Lord. Send us that we may answer the call and be your servants. Give us traveling mercies now and forever. Amen. God bless you and God keep you.
Members of the National Board of Directors, delegates and guests, on behalf of Chairman of the Board Leon W. Russell, Vice Chair Karen Boykin-Towns, President and CEO Derek Johnson, it is my esteemed pleasure to bring the 113th National Convention to a close. In the infamous words of Marty Small, it's been a great week. Be safe on your travels.